Welcome into the Monday episode of the David Hookstead Show. Really happy to have you all here as always. What a wild time it has been since this past Friday. I have a lot of things I want to go over with you all. Obviously, first and foremost, I'm not going to waste any time. The Kyle Rittenhouse verdict. Let's just talk about the Kyle Rittenhouse verdict. I was sitting on my couch Friday afternoon waiting for the verdict to come in. I think it came in about, 1:30 Eastern time. I had family members back home that were locked in on their TVs, sitting around in silence, waiting for the verdict to come in. This whole thing should have been done by Tuesday night at the latest. It went until Friday afternoon as the jury deliberated before they came back and acquitted him on all five counts. I was so happy that I honestly could have cried tears of joy. I was so happy sitting there watching Kyle Rittenhouse get acquitted that I honestly could have teared up. I thought maybe I was going to tear up because this situation with Kyle Rittenhouse was nothing more than a political hit job, a politically motivated show trial. And if there was any justice left in America, he had to be acquitted on all five counts. Now, that's not to say that you have to agree with Kyle Rittenhouse being there, or you have to think Kyle Rittenhouse did everything perfectly. That's not what I'm saying. By the letter of the law, Kyle Rittenhouse didn't do anything wrong. And furthermore, I'll take that a step furthermore, past just the letter of the law, I fully support and I fully endorse a human's right to self-defense and to exercise the Second Amendment as they see fit to stay alive. Okay? He didn't go out there and shoot angels. He went out there and shot three people who attacked him. He shot a convicted child sex predator who chased him down and spent the last moments of his life trying to attack one more kid. And as as his attorney said in one of these interviews, he didn't think Kyle had the guts to do it. He was wrong. He paid with his life. Anthony Huber, also absolutely no angel, whatever, attacks Kyle Rittenhouse in the middle of the street, pays with his life. Gage Grosskreutz pulls a weapon on Kyle Rittenhouse, gets his arm blown apart, 100% had it coming. So this is a sign to me that Kyle Rittenhouse got acquitted, that the system does work. Despite the attempts to intimidate the jury, despite the government officials that were on the record spreading heinous lies, heinous false information, misinformation about the trial, the jury did what the jury had to do, which was acquit on all counts. They blocked out the noise. They showed great courage. They showed having a steel, titanium steel spine. It would have been so easy for them to cave and just convict him because that would have been the easy thing to do. And if that had happened, self-defense, the Second Amendment, and justice in America would have taken either a huge blow or just have been outright over. Instead, everything came across. The facts came across in the trial. The evidence spoke for itself. And Kyle Rittenhouse is a free man. To quote the shirt he allegedly wore once, free as fuck. It would have been disgraceful if he spent 1 second behind bars after this show trial that you expect to see out of North Korea or the Soviet Union. I am so damn proud of everyone involved. His defense team did an excellent job. The judge, I thought, did an excellent job being fair, sticking to the Constitution, sticking to the rules of the law. He didn't try to be an activist judge. He didn't try to, tip the scales in favor of the prosecution. He honored the rights of the defense. He could not have been a better judge. And he kind of stole the show. He had a few fun quips. I thought he was actually the real star of the whole thing. I'm exuberant. I'm happy. I spoke about this every day last week with you. This is where I'm from. I'm from Wisconsin. I know people involved in this situation. I think Kyle Rittenhouse should not have been there, number one. That was the biggest mistake he made, was thinking he could make a difference in a situation that was long past saving. But every time he pulled that trigger and every bullet he fired was not just 100% justified, it had to happen. I stand with Kyle Rittenhouse. I fully support his complete and total acquittal. It was a great day for America. It was a great day for the justice system. And all the idiots on TV still spreading lies about Kyle Rittenhouse, still spreading lies, claiming he fired indiscriminately into a crowd, claiming he's a racist and all the above. I hope you have good lawyers, because I hope Kyle Rittenhouse sues the fuck out of all of you. And that's all I have to say about that. Enjoy your life, Kyle. Have a few beers on me. He has a standing open invitation to appear on the David Hookstead Show whenever he wants. I would love to get him in front of you guys, the audience. Kyle, they never should have done this to you. This entire trial was an embarrassment to the justice system. But those jurors did their job, and you're now a free man. And I am incredibly happy for you. Like I said, I know people who cried back in the state of Wisconsin. That's how hard this trial was for many of them to watch. So good for you. Free as fuck. I love it. Speaking of, on the flip side of that, let's talk about some idiots. LeBron James was ejected Sunday night against the Pistons for throwing a dirty cheap shot. And then what does he do? He backs off, allows his teammates to get in the scuffle. Just pathetic behavior from LeBron James, which is what we've come to expect. Of course, this is who he is. And this is, he's an attention-driven diva. He doesn't want to take responsibility. He always thinks he's right. And you saw that on the court last night. But that's not actually what happened Sunday that I thought was most interesting with LeBron. Enes Kanter went on CNN and said he's spoken with LeBron's former teammates. And LeBron's former teammates say that his actual social activism, all that you see is SJW bullshit, it's not real. It's all a PR machine. It's all calculated PR moves. And I'll say this, LeBron James claimed, you know, he didn't talk to Enes Kanter during the Celtics-Lakers game. He claimed Kanter walked away from him. Now, Kanter said that's not true. LeBron walked away from him without saying anything. LeBron James is one of the most pathetic, I think is the right word to use, pathetic celebrities in all of America. He bows down to the Chinese dictatorship. He cashes Nike checks like nothing's happening. Then Enes Kanter, who will likely lose his career over this situation, will likely lose his career for taking a stand up to Nike, for taking a stand to LeBron James, for taking a stand to China. He calls out LeBron James, and LeBron James tries to play victim and holier than thou. It's disgusting. LeBron James, if he had any backbone whatsoever, would answer for his silence on the crimes of China. And look, I would at least respect LeBron if he came out and said, yeah, I make a ton of money thanks to China. I don't want to take food out of my kids' mouths. I like being rich. Deal with it. I would disagree with it, but at least then he'd be being honest. And instead, he just sits there silently. He pretends that it's not him. He pretends like he hasn't done anything wrong. He goes after Enes Kanter for speaking up. The whole thing is ridiculous. He is no hero. LeBron James is not a hero. He's not a genius. He's not a philosopher. He's a clown. Okay? He is a clown. That is who LeBron James is. And when I see the way he treats Enes Kanter, and when I see the way that he behaves through all this, it's quite frankly nothing short of sickening. And I don't know why we allow LeBron James to get away with it. He should be held accountable. If you want to cash in off your relationship with China, then you should be responsible. You should be held accountable for that. China's top tennis player has not been seen, apparently, reportedly, since she alleged sexual misconduct and assault against a high-ranking Chinese government official. LeBron James has time to weigh in on Kyle Rittenhouse, but he doesn't have time to speak out for human rights in China. How does that make sense to anyone? He'll trash an innocent teenager who killed a convicted child predator. He'll trash that guy, but he won't speak out against the Chinese dictatorship for disappearing the top female tennis player in the country. So I'm sitting here confused as to whose side LeBron James is on. Are you on the side of American freedom? Or are you on the side of the communist dictatorship? It really seems like you're on the side of China. Now again, open invitation. If he wants to come here on the David Hookstead Show and explain himself, I'm happy to hear him out. But quite frankly, LeBron James, do we just ignore him going forward? I can't take him seriously. I just can't. Speaking of stuff that is incredibly stupid, Baker Mayfield's wife, Emily Mayfield, shared an Instagram post that she did not write. She reshared someone else's post claiming that the rest of the team needs to get as tough as Baker is. I will never understand why significant others weigh in on stuff like this. I will never understand why significant others of movie stars, athletes, politicians, whatever it might be, male or female, weigh in on stuff they have no part. Does she think sharing that is going to make his time in the locker room better or worse? Is her calling all of his teammates weak, who need to be as tough as him, going to make his life better or worse in the locker room? So I'm just going to make it a lot worse. Ladies or men, if you're married to a successful, famous woman who is, you know, in the public spotlight, don't get involved in things you are not a part of. It's like that famous Bill Burr segment. If a plumber came over and he was like, I think you have a leak in this room, and the wife then showed up, he was like, I actually think the leak's coming from up here. It's not your job. Just don't. Do not get involved. If you're married to the president, let the president do his job, okay? Do first lady things. Don't get involved in politics and policy. That's not your job, right? And if you are married to the most famous female athlete, like let's say you're Ronda Rousey's husband. She's married to an MMA fighter herself, I believe. You don't need to be getting involved in Ronda Rousey beefs when it comes to the UFC, right? Assuming that would have happened when she was still fighting. Let the athletes, let the politicians, let the movie stars do their own thing. Spouses, male or female, do not get involved. You are only going to make the situation worse. I would love to know what Baker Mayfield told his wife after that post. Just mind-bogglingly stupid. All right, Florida has fired Dan Mullen. Now, when Coach O was fired by LSU, I thought there was no way we would have another firing and downfall that bad. Now, Dan Mullen's downfall isn't as bad because he didn't just win a national title a couple of years ago, but it is mind-boggling how fast things got out of control in Gainesville, Florida. I mean, we went from thinking Dan Mullen is going to have the Gators competing to he's fired. Everything went downhill after that LSU loss last year. When that LSU loss happened, all hell broke loose. They've been terrible ever since. The program's out of control. He has no idea what's going on. Dan Mullen is out. It's a stunning firing to me. I just can't believe it, but here we are. All right, let's talk a little college football, a little more college football. Dan Patrick reported the playoff might expand to 12 teams as soon as next season. A decision needs to be made in December, coming up here in a couple weeks, in what, 9 days? I'm looking at the calendar here, 8-9 days. If it's not made in December to expand next year, 2025 is the soonest it can happen. So let's all keep our fingers crossed that happens in 2022 because the playoff has to expand. The same four teams going every year is not going to get the job done. Fans are not happy with that. We're not okay with it. We want the 12 teams. Send the Power 5 champions plus one G5 champion. It's 6 at-large bids. I think it works perfectly. I like it a lot. Just get it done. It's not that hard. Just get it done, as they would say. All right, the Badgers beat Nebraska by a touchdown. Game was way closer than I thought it would be. You know, our defense did not look good, but Braylon Allen, I call him the child because he's only 17. We have to feed the child. He had like 228 yards, 3 touchdowns. So I actually was at the Navy game this past weekend. I went up with Armed Forces Brewing. We had a bunch of Navy SEAL guys were up there. Rob O'Neill was up there. Great event. But in the suite, we had the Badgers game on. So we're watching the Navy game on the field. We got the Badgers game on. I couldn't get enough of it. You know, it's just any Saturday you get to enjoy college football. Like I tweeted on Saturday morning, Kyle Rittenhouse is free. College football is on TV all day. The beer is ice cold in the fridge. We're in for a great day. Now we have one game against Minnesota for all the marbles of the Big Ten West. We win the Big Ten West. We go to the Big Ten title game against Ohio State. Here's what I'll say about this, and I mean it sincerely. I didn't forget everyone who trashed us, okay? I said was very critical of the team, but that's me policing my own. It's one thing for me to be critical of the Badgers as a huge Badger fan. I'm holding my people accountable. But for all the outside noise and when we were 1-3, everyone wrote us off. Everyone thought we were trash. We wouldn't even make a bowl game. Now we're 8-3. We're 60 minutes of good football away from playing Ohio State most likely in the Big Ten title game. And I just want to let you all know, I have not forgotten. And I'll tell you this much. We're going to crush Minnesota. We're a touchdown favorite. I believe it's going to not even be close. I feel like we are going to roll through Minnesota this Saturday. I cannot wait to see what happens. It is going to be a hell of a game. Hell of a game, gentlemen. It's going to be an absolutely awesome experience. Look, you counted us out. You were wrong. Admit it. It's okay. Finally, new Yellowstone episode aired Sunday night. Spoiler. I'm going to give you a couple seconds to exit out of this if you don't want to hear it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. All right, if you're here, I'm assuming you've watched the episode. My theory has always been, since day one, that Jamie's dad orchestrated this whole thing without Jamie's knowledge, and that seemed to have been proven correct in this episode. Because when Jamie got the prison file of the guy who put the hit team together, Garrett Randall, his biological father, had a close connection to him for a few years. So they know each other. There's a connection there. Okay, that makes me think the father set it up and Jamie's totally unaware, which leads there's going to be some clash. Look, Jamie in the talk with Casey said he is protecting the family. He did the lease instead of selling the land. He put police protection on John Dutton in the hospital. He made sure the killings at the ranch just disappeared. He made sure the killing that Casey did just disappeared. It is, it. My theory, I hate to brag, looks like it's going to be 100% accurate. Anyways, you need to be watching Yellowstone if you haven't been already. It's off to an insane start. I love it. It's really good. Anyways, that's all we have for the Monday episode of the David Hookstead Show. Make sure to check back Tuesday as we gear up for Thanksgiving for an all-new one. Have a great day.